Somebody shout, he's the king. You are the king, so we say, hail Jesus, you're my king.
Your life
brings
me to sing.
I will praise you all my day.
Perfect
in all your ways.
Hail Jesus,
you're my Lord.
Your kingdom come.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Hail Jesus, you're my king.
Your life brings me to sing.
I will pray
all my days.
Perfect in all your ways.
You're my Lord.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I want to see your kingdom
come. Not my will, but yours be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You will take us into the land.
And we will conquer in your name.
Oh, and proclaim that Jesus reigns.
Hail Jesus, you're my king.
Your life brings me to sing.
I will praise you all my days.
You're perfect. In all your ways.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your
word.
Yes, I
want to
see
your kingdom come.
Say not my will, but yours be
done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
And we will conquer in your name.
And we proclaim that Jesus
reigns.
Hail,
hail,
Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
For you are,
how powerful you are.
Everybody shout it out.
For you are,
how
wonderful
you are.
Hail,
hail,
Lion of Judah.
How powerful you
are.
Yeah.
You can Praise the Most High God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and peace to everybody that's here in the name of Jesus. Peace to everybody tuning in on the phone line, and also tuning in with us on the internet. And glad to be here. We was here last night. We be doing it all day on the Sabbath day. We was here late last night and back here today. After we get through streaming live this lesson, then L.A. gonna be coming on right after us. So we got the word flowing. And when I say the word, I know a lot of preachers talk about the word, say they dealing with the word, but we mean the word. And we prove it by reading it right out the Bible. We got a big Bible here for that very reason. God didn't leave us a big Bible to just go on hearsay, to go on what the preacher feel like. God want us to know what he is about. And the only way you can know that, brothers and sisters, is through the word. So we're going to deal with something that's real popular in the world, but it haven't been substantiated nowhere in the Bible. And that is the doctrine of the Trinity. Because we've all heard of that. It's just almost like second nature to accept certain things that's not biblical. But I know why Revelation 12 tells you that Satan have deceived the whole world. That's not in the Bible for nothing. We going for stuff. It's like three-card Molly. We just going for the okey-doke. That's why Jesus himself, you say you believe in Jesus, do you believe when Jesus said, beware of false prophets? So we don't just take anything that's being thrown our way supposedly about God. Now, I know somebody might say, well, you know, because I've showed this to people individually, just talking to them, I showed them, look, you know, this is wrong. There's no rapture. We got a lesson to deal with that. That's another lesson. There's no Trinity. Trinity, the word Trinity, for it to be so popular and so big, the word is not nowhere in the Bible. Find it to me. Show it to me. That's not the whole case, even if the word not in there. If the Bible substantiated that there really was a Trinity, I would have to go with it. But the word is not there, and the doctrine itself is not there. But I've told people this individually, talked to them, and they argue with me. Oh, no, I know it's a Trinity. The Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Yeah, we know it's a Father and a Son and a Holy Ghost, but we're going to find out, do they all make up the Godhead? We're going to do some reading. But I've showed it to them. They was arguing with me. Then they took the time. If anybody take time to look at the scripture and you got your mind open, you'll see it. And they saw it. I seen some people see it. And then the only thing they could say is, well, it really don't matter anyway. What you mean it don't matter? Well, what difference do it make if it's two or three? Look, you've been believing a lie. It make a difference. So we're going to start off and show you that anything you believe in false, it matters, brothers and sisters. You believing it about God and it's not true, it matters. And I'm going to show you that. We're going to start off in Matthew 16. The title is The Trinity, False Doctrine from Satan. And that's the way it is. See, I'm not even bashful. I'm not ashamed to say it's from Satan. See, because we know what we're talking about. We can read it out the Bible. So if I'm wrong, I'm calling God Satan. If I'm wrong, but I know I'm not wrong. We can prove it out the Bible. And that's where it's from, because Satan always getting you off track. They bringing around the lesson handouts now, so you can follow along with us. And you can see we ain't playing when we talking about reading the Bible. See, a lot of preachers might say, yeah, we're going to show you the word. We're going to show you the word. And they get up and they read a half a verse. Sometimes I seen a preacher, he'd be sitting back there, the choir singing. He's sitting back there, and then he get up like he going to say something, and the choir take over again. He go back and sit down. They don't never, by the time they get to the word, everybody sleep. Then he give a half a verse. But we going to show what the title said, the Trinity is false doctrine from Satan. Matthew 16 is where we're going to start at. Matthew 16. See, this is all important. See, you might say, well, if it's two or it's three, because we know we're going to prove that the Father is God. Everybody know that. That's common sense. We can show that. We know that the Son is even a part of the God family. But the Holy Ghost, that's another story. We know who he is, and he is not a part of the God family. He's not God. Because you would be able to see that. You wouldn't have to guess at it. Like I say all the time, for the Trinity to be so important, so popular, you should have a boatload of stuff in the Bible to back it up. You shouldn't have to go to one place. You got churches named Trinity. That means their whole foundation is straight up built on a lie. But even if they're not named Trinity, the majority of the churches believe in it. He had a little sister singing group named, I think it was the name Trinity too. Yeah, because we're going to read Trinity 5:7. We're going to read 1 John 5:7. That's the main place people go. And we're going to go there. We ain't scared to go nowhere in the Bible. But, you know, they name themselves after a lot. But look at this here, Matthew 16. This is not really about the lesson, kind of like a little introduction, but it's going to show you something, how Jesus feel about you speaking contrary to what he's about. Matthew 16 and 21. Go ahead.
In charge, he is disciple. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day.
Okay, now Jesus showing his disciples the future. What is getting ready to happen? He's showing his disciples. He said, from that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things. And suffer many things of who? Of the elders and chief priests and scribes of the people, and be killed and raised again the third day. First of all, people don't even pay attention to what happened to Jesus, really. People don't pay attention to what happened to Jesus. We've all heard it. Oh, yeah, Jesus died for my sin. He died for my sin. But look, pay attention. Jesus didn't just lay down and die for your sins, did he? He didn't just lay down and die. He didn't just get old and die. Somebody killed Jesus, and some wicked people killed Jesus for their own selfish reasons. Wicked people did it. Wicked people killed Jesus. And what wicked people? Was it the people running the streets, pimping and prostituting? Were they the people mad at Jesus and did something to him? Nope. Who was it? Read verse 21 again, and let's see who it was.
From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests.
Oh, the elders and chief priests. The religious people, the religious establishment killed Jesus. The elders and chief priests and what else?
And scribes.
They the religious leaders too. Go ahead.
And be killed and be raised again the third day.
Okay. He told him that. Now what Peter said, verse 22.
Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee.
See, this is a good thing to recognize, because people say all the time, you try to tell them something about the word, they say, yeah, well, I might not know that and do that, but see, God know my heart. And he know my intentions. My intentions. Look, it don't matter, brothers and sisters. You need to understand God for real. You can have good intentions. If you on the wrong path, you got to get that straight. You can have good intentions. The old saying is true, the road to hell is paved with what?
Good intentions.
You can have good intentions, and you could still be out of pocket with God, and God going to let you know. People say, well, God know my heart. Yeah, you know what the Bible say about that? The Bible say the heart is desperately wicked above all things. That's why you got to change your heart to fit God's demands. So now, I'm saying that because verse 22, well, verse 21, Jesus said he's getting ready to go be crucified, be killed. The chief priest going to do all this too. Peter didn't mean nothing bad. Peter had good intentions. He didn't think the Lord should have to go through that, brothers and sisters. That's what he said at verse 22. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto you. You know, all this bad stuff don't need to happen to you. You the Lord. Why should that happen to you? What did Jesus think about that statement? Peter meant well. 23.
But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan.
Oh, you see that? Jesus turned around and called this boy. This is boy. Satan. One of his main apostles. And Peter went on to do great things, but he was out of pocket here, wasn't he? He was way out of pocket. See, it don't matter about your intention. Either you right with God or you wrong. At this moment, Peter was dead wrong, and he was speaking really through the mouth. Satan was speaking through him. He's going to try to convince Jesus like he ain't got to die. Look, it don't matter if you mean well. Jesus said, get thee behind me, Satan. So that statement, that little isolated statement that you might say, well, you know, it don't. Come on, it wasn't that bad. Well, Jesus thought it was that bad, didn't he? He said, get thee behind me, Satan. Why?
Thou art an offense unto me.
He said, he's talking to Peter, though. Thou art an offense unto me. Go ahead.
For thou savorest not the things that be of God,
uh-huh,
but those that be of men.
Yeah, but those that be of men. So it do matter. So for the people who say, well, you know, if it's two or three, it don't matter. Look, everybody as a whole got this doctrine of the Trinity, thinking it's three members. It came from Rome. The Pope is the one that gave you that. And you believe in that naively. You believe in that. It is not from God. It's a false doctrine. And if you can see that it's false in the Bible, it's no way that you should be believing in a doctrine of a Trinity. Now, we're going to get into it. We're going to go to 2 Timothy 4, because Paul told you something else about our days. Because when we say the Trinity is false doctrine from Satan, we ain't playing. It's another thing to get you off track, looking at God the wrong way. We believe everything that some man can come up and tell us, but we don't want to believe nothing in the Bible. That's what always amazed me. We'll take what man say in a minute. Man gave you Christmas. Nowhere in the Bible. We'd take that. But then when you talk to somebody about the holy days that's in the Word of God, people start looking at you from, what's that about? It's in the Bible. The Passover that Jesus celebrated in the Bible. That's why we celebrate it. It referenced him. It's about him. That's why we celebrate it. But people think, since they ain't heard about it, they preach it, ain't gave it to them. Told you the Lord said, beware of false prophets. They think something wrong with it. But what man give you Christmas, Jesus born on December 25th. Everybody know that's a lie, brothers and sisters. Anybody do any little research, know Jesus wasn't born on December 21st. Just a little research. All you got to do, look up, Chris. They got encyclopedias. They got Google. They got all kind of stuff for you to look this stuff up. No, Jesus wasn't born on December 25th. And Jeremiah 10 tell you about putting a tree in your house. We doing stuff naively. But it's not about God. Even if I gave you that Jesus was born on December 20, what would the tree have to do with it? It wouldn't have nothing to do with it. That's a false god. You bring it in your house, decorating it, sitting up there going through all that mess, buying gifts for people. People you don't even like no more. I gotta get so-and-so a gift. Gotta get him. Spending all your money, now you broke. I ain't lying. I had people, I stopped celebrating Christmas almost 30 years ago. Had people always after Christmas, they come begging for some money. You gotta feel it. No, why you spend all your money on Christmas? You done blew your money you didn't even have. For no good reason. No, had nothing to do with God. But we believe stuff that man give us. We don't believe what the word say. Notice what Paul said about some of this stuff. 2 Timothy 4. 2 Timothy 4 and verse 1. Go ahead.
I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom.
See, we still ain't getting to the actual part of the lesson, but even this touching on a little bit. Why? Because Paul is saying, I charge thee before God. Who is that referencing? The Father, right? Mm-hmm. I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. So he only gave us two in that verse, right? Mm-hmm. And we're going to get to the third one, but I'm here to tell you, brother and sister, he is not God. We know who he is. He ain't God. But here we got two. Paul said, I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead. That means the quick means living. And the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. See, this is what the whole, this is what it's all about in a nutshell. Jesus is going to make a second appearing, a second coming, and he's going to take over this world. He's going to bang some heads and take over this world and set a heavenly kingdom up on earth. You ain't going to heaven. That's some more man-made doctrine. Jesus is coming here. He even told you to pray, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth. But we talking about, oh, we're going to go up to heaven. That's a lie from Satan. You ain't going up there. The best you're going to get is meeting the Lord in the clouds if you're worthy. And then y'all, everybody coming back down on the earth to take it over. That's what the Lord, that's why he's saying, Jesus Christ, who going to judge the quick and the dead at his appearing. He got to come back. And his kingdom. But now, Paul is given a charge before the Father and the Son to do what? What's the charge? Go ahead.
Preach the word.
Uh-huh.
Be instant in season.
Oh, preach the word and be ready all the time. Instant in season. Go ahead.
Out of season.
Uh-huh.
Rebuke. Uh-huh. Reprove. Rebuke. Exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine.
See, now notice what Paul said? He said, preach the word. Be ready all the time. Reprove. Rebuke. See, some people say, oh, well, why are you saying they wrong? Why are you saying pointing out that they wrong? Because the Bible told me to do it, didn't it? What do reprove and rebuke mean? If you rebuke somebody with the word, you telling them you wrong according to the word. Ain't nothing wrong with that. He telling us to do it, right? Reprove, rebuke with all long-suffering and doctrine. See, that's why we taking the time to read the Bible. Because we got God's doctrine, not man. Go ahead, verse 3.
For the time will come.
Oh, Paul knew what was coming. He knew after his time, later on down the road, and we way down the road, how it was going to be. For the time will come what?
When they will not endure sound doctrine.
Oh, brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you. Paul said the time will come. I'm here to tell you all the stuff we've been mentioning. The time is here. The time is here. When people won't endure sound doctrine, they won't endure simply what the word of God is saying. Because you've been brainwashed with something else. Paul knew it was coming. He knew it wasn't going to get better. He knew it was going to get worse. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. But what they going to do?
But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itchy ears.
Oh, after their own lust. See, people want to hear what they want to hear. I have talked to ministers, brothers and sisters, and we talked about some of the same things. Look, I tell preacher, whether you know, that's not right. That's not right. A lot of the preachers know better. It's very few of these preachers out here that's simply deceived. They just deceivers. They just deceive. I had preachers tell me, oh, yeah, I know that. But the people don't want to hear that. It ain't your job to tell them what they want to hear. It's your job to tell them what the Lord say. But this is where he got it from. He said, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having it. So the people want to hear what they want to hear, and the average preacher is giving it to them. But what they end up doing, verse 4.
And they shall turn away their ears from the truth.
And that's what's going on now. People have turned away their ears from the truth. The simple truth is in the Bible. People don't want to endure that. They turned away their ears from the truth and what?
And shall be turned unto fable.
And shall be turned unto fable. You know what a fable is, don't you? That's a lie. And that's what the Trinity is, brother and sister. It's a fable. That's one of the fables we didn't turn to, believing it's three members that make up God. Go ahead.
But watch thou in all things.
But go ahead.
Endure affliction and do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry.
See, we making proof because we reading the Bible. If you got the handout now, you see we got almost 30 scriptures on the handout. And we going to read them. And it ain't going to take that long. And that's better than me standing up here reading a half a verse and giving you a nice stir. I can talk just as well as anybody else. I can read a half verse and talk. But that ain't going to do you no good. I can tell you a whole lot. I can make up some nice stuff. Like I say all the time, I was at my grandmother's funeral. The guy got up there, ain't said nothing, gave a nice little stuff. And when I got up this morning, I got up and I got ready to iron my shirt. And my shirt, I mean, people like that. And my aunt, after it was over, my aunt told me, oh, he really preached. I wanted to hit her. He preached. What did you learn from that? I got ready to iron my shirt, and my shirt talked back to me and said, ah, don't burn me. I said, shirt, what you doing talking back to me? And that's preaching. You ain't getting none from that. But now, go to Acts 17. We call that preaching. You ain't getting nothing about the Lord. I can tell you a whole lot of stories, but that ain't going to help you with the Lord. You stand before the Lord talking about, yeah, you know, but Brother Elijah was telling me how he did this, he did that. The Lord said, look, I told you to beware of false prophets. You got to get the word. Acts 17, and we're going to pick it up at verse 16. Acts 17 and 16. Go ahead.
Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the whole city wholly given to idolatry.
Okay, now again, brothers and sisters, we can't just lay down and accept when people are lying to people, sending them to hell. Because people say all the time, well, y'all really be, you know, y'all be hitting on other people. Can we all get along? No, we can't all get along because people being lied to by these preachers. So we gonna point it out every time. And that's what the people did in the Bible. Paul just was telling in Timothy, he said, reprove, rebuke, with long suffering and doctrine. Here, Paul went to this place called Athens, right? And notice that he said his spirit was stirred in him. Why was his spirit stirred in him? He said when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. See, preachers don't even talk about idolatry no more, but that's all that false worship. Christmas is idolatry. The Trinity, that's getting into idolatry. You worshiping something that ain't even right. You getting into idolatry. And you shouldn't do that. Paul was upset that they was worshiping stuff they didn't even understand. Like I said, you don't have no idea what a tree would have to do with Jesus' birthday because you worshiping an old false god, an old pagan god. It ain't got nothing to do with Jesus or this Bible. Just because they say it's his birthday, you can't go for the hype. So he said, look, when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry, so what did he do about that? Did he just say, oh, well, it really don't matter. You know, you do it your way, I do it my way, and we are all okay. Now, what did he do? Paul, 17.
Therefore disputed he in the synagogues with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him.
See, people say, well, you shouldn't really dispute the word of God. Look, if somebody wrong, you should tell them. And if they want to debate about it, we have debate. You show what you got, I'll show what I got. And we will see who the Lord is with. That's what Paul did, didn't he? Mm-hmm. It said he disputed everywhere he caught them. In the synagogue, with the devout persons, in the market daily with them that met with him. He would say, look, you're dealing with a lie. That's a lie. That's not right. But now save a little time. We're going to skip down to verse 22 because we got so many scriptures we can't read all of it. We just focusing on what we focusing on. 22, go ahead.
Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious.
Uh-huh. See, you say he said you superstitious. That's where Christmas come out of, some superstition. You don't even know that. Why? Because really, I'm going to tell you what Christmas is about. It's the winter solstice, when the shortest year of the year, shortest day of the year is past. So they start worshiping the sun back in those days. And they just going to tell you it's Jesus' birthday, but they worshiping the sun because from now on, the days keep getting shorter. You get less daylight, less daylight. Days get shorter and shorter. Sun go down early and early until around December 25th. Then they start getting longer and longer up into the summertime. So man recognized that a long time ago. They said, oh, the sun is reborn, so we're going to have a celebration to worship the sun in the sky. That's what the Christmas is about. It's superstition. They was afraid of the dark. That's why they got lights everywhere. It ain't about Jesus. They got light. You put lights. You decorate the tree. They celebrating that now the days are going to get longer. You don't know what. We doing stuff. We don't have a clue. Like mistletoe and Yuletide. That's all these false religions. They ain't got nothing to do with Jesus. So he said it here. He said, in everything, y'all too superstitious. Go ahead, verse 23.
For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with the inscription to the unknown God.
Uh-huh.
And therefore you ignorantly worship him, declare I unto you.
See, you need to know about God. See, they didn't have a clue about God. They said to the unknown God. No, he can be known. He gave you a record of him. Paul said, I'm going to break him down. I'm going to let you know about the real God. Because I know about him. But go ahead, 24.
God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelling not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with man's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things.
We need God. He don't need us, but go ahead.
And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth.
Uh-huh.
And have determined the times before appointed and bounds of their habitation.
See, he made of one. He started with one, and he made all these different nations and nationalities. We all go back to the same Father. That's how awesome God is. Color, that's why color don't matter. We all go back to the same Father, but go ahead.
That they should seek the Lord, if happily they might feel after him,
uh-huh,
and find him, though he be not far from every one of us.
Uh-huh.
For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring.
See, now Paul said, look, I'm going to tell you about the real God. You worshiping ignorantly. I'm going to tell you about the real one. But he going to say something else. 29.
For as much then as we are the offspring of God.
Now, we the offspring of God. That's what people don't understand, too. We are made in God's image. We look like God. Some of the angels, they got four faces and calf feet. They don't look like man, but we look like God. We was made in his image. For as much as we are the offspring of God, we what?
We ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's devices.
See, we ought not to look at the Godhead like these, all these pictures and images they make. But notice, he says something about a Godhead. That's what you need to understand. It is a Godhead. Godhead means more than one member that make up God. That's why I use the term Godhead in the Bible. We ought not to look at the Godhead. See, Godhead means just like a word, just like family. If I use the word family, you automatically know, even though I'm talking about one family, I'm talking about more than one individual. You know that automatically. If I say family, you know it ain't talking about one person, but it's still one family. So that's what Godhead signifies, is one whole made up of many parts. But we got to see how many parts. See, that's where the lie come in at. They say the Godhead is made up of a Trinity. That's what the doctrine of the Trinity is. It says it's Father, it's the Son, and it's the Holy Ghost. That is the Godhead. No, we beg to differ. And if it's not a Trinity, we ought not to look at the Godhead as a Trinity. He just told us we ought not to think that the Godhead is like gold, silver, or stone, or graven art of man's device, right? We ought not to look at it as a Trinity if it's not. Because you worshiping something in ignorance. Go ahead, verse 30.
In the times of this ignorance, God winked at.
Uh-huh.
But now commanded all men everywhere to repent.
See, God telling us to repent and get to know him as it's written, as what we can read in the Bible. Now, let's go look at the Godhead. Go to Genesis 1. We're going to get into it now, and we're going to see. If it's a Trinity, brothers and sisters, I could care less. It wouldn't matter to me. I'd be preaching it. But because it's a lie, I got to preach that it's a lie. If we find three members in this Bible that make up the Godhead, it wouldn't matter to me. But if we only find two, then you know the Trinity is a lie. And we're going to see. See, it's always been more than one. People don't understand. Jesus didn't just drop out the sky. Jesus just wasn't born of Mary. Jesus was around way back in the beginning. So he in there. Genesis 1, though. All the way back to the beginning. Everybody ever probably get to a certain age, they at least read this. Because everybody say, I'm going to read the Bible. They start here and they probably read about five verses. And then they sit there so long, then they go back and say, I'm going to read the Bible again. They start back here again. Read about 10 verses. But then forgot where they was at. I forgot where I was. I'm going to start over again. Never get done. So you know about this. Genesis 1 and 1. Go ahead.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
Okay, in the beginning, God created the heaven and earth. Well, Paul just told us something about a Godhead, right?
Right.
Paul told us something about a Godhead. We need to get some knowledge of the Godhead. So now it said in the beginning. Keep in mind, this is in the beginning. God created the heaven and the earth. Now he did all these things on each day. Then he got down to the sixth day when he made man. Because he set the stage for man, because man is to be over everything. In the end, brothers and sisters, God made it so we can even be like him and be over the angels that he created. That's our destiny if we do what we're supposed to do. But skip down to verse 26 to see what he did when he brought man on the scene. Genesis 1 and 26. Go ahead.
And God said, let us make man in our image,
uh-huh,
after our likeness, and let him have dominion over the fish of the sea,
uh-huh,
the fowl of the air,
uh-huh,
and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
Oh, now notice, verse 26 said, we saw in the beginning God created the heaven and earth. Now we get down to verse 26. It said, and God said. So first off the bat, God is talking, right? God said, let us make man in our image. And the one he talking to is just like him. Why? Because he said, let us. So it's more than one right here. Already is more than one. That's what the Godhead means. It is more than one. I understand that. But I'm here to show you it's not a Trinity. But now it's more than one because he's talking. He said, let us make man in our image. He's not talking to angels either because angels, not man, not made in angel image. God has a different appearance than angels. God looked just like we look. In other words, God got a head, hands, feet. The Bible show you that description. Legs, 2 feet, 2 hands, angels. They got wings. They got... Four faces, calf feet. You can read that description in Ezekiel, the first chapter. So we not made, you ain't seen no people walking around there in that image, have you? Because you would fall out. You would faint. What the heck? But now, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and we're going to let them have dominion. So now God said it, and now verse 26, 27, what does it say?
So God created man in his own image.
Wait a minute, what is really going on here? God, is God talking to himself? He obviously talking to somebody, right? Mm-hmm. So he ain't talking to himself. He ain't like he's schizo. God said, well, let us make man in our own image. Okay, I think I'll do that. Nah, he talking to somebody else just like him. See, be back here, brothers and sisters, wasn't no father, wasn't no son. They was just God. See, Jesus did a great thing by giving up being God. He did a great thing. So he said, God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Then notice 27 says, so God created man in his own image. Wait a minute. It went back to a singular. Because he did it, and once he did it in his image, he had already did it in the other one's image because they identical. You know how I know? Jesus said something in John 14. We don't have time to read all this. But his disciples said, man, why don't you just show us the Father? Jesus told Philip, he said, man, how long you been with me all this time? You don't know when you see me, you see the Father? He told them that. Because they on the same page. So that's why I said, let us make man in our image. So one of them told, the Father, the one we know as the Father said, look, let us make man in our image. You know what happened? The one other one did it. So that's why I said, so God created man in his own image. And what image was it?
In the image of God created he him.
Oh, not angels too. No, in the image of God created he man. Created he him. Go ahead.
Male and female created he them.
Male and female, because that's what make up man. It's not just a male. Man, that's why the Bible don't have to say man and woman all the time. It's a man that covers the male and the female. Because that's mankind. So he made man in his image. But we're going to get some understanding of this. Let's go to John. Because we let the Bible explain itself. John, the first chapter. See, the Bible interprets itself. I don't have to sit there and interpret it for you and say, well, you know, this means this. Another preacher comes and says, no, brother, it means this. And we can argue for 40 years. But if we find some scripture to back it up, we know what it means. We ain't guessing. That's how I know the Trinity is false doctrine from Satan. Because we got the scripture to back it up. John 1. Now notice, this is how you get understanding. You read about the same thing in other places and it'll break it down further for you. You ain't got to try to figure it out. Your mind can't figure it out. That's why people can't even read the whole Bible. They sit there and get stuck on one verse. What does that mean? I wonder what that means. Like you can't figure it out. You got to find it somewhere else in the Word. See, we just helping you out here. We done found it already, just showing it to you. John 1 and verse 1. John 1 and 1. Go ahead.
In the beginning was the Word.
Wait a minute now. It's only one beginning, right?
Right.
We just read, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Mm-hmm. Then we read where he dropped down and he made man. He said, let us make man in our image. And then he turned around. The other one did it in his own image. But it's only one beginning. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. In the beginning was the Word. Go ahead.
And the Word was with God.
Uh-huh.
And the Word was God.
Wait a minute. How many is in that one verse? Two. It's only two in that verse. See, before I got some understanding, I said, what that mean, the Word? What does that mean, the Word? The Word is that's like talking words. No, it ain't got nothing to do with talking words here. This is somebody called the Word. This is his title. His title is the Word. Revelation 19, when Jesus come back, it say his name is called the Word of God.
Right.
See, he do the talking for God. So this is an individual that's known as the Word. It said in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Now this individual was with God. Then it said, and the Word was God. Mm-hmm. He with God, and he God just like God. Two of them. We don't got three. It didn't say in the beginning was the Word and the Holy Ghost, and the Word and the Holy Ghost was with God, and the Word and the Holy Ghost with God. Didn't say that, did it?
No.
It just only gave us two right here. Go ahead, verse 2.
The same was in the beginning with God.
Oh, the same who? The same individual called the Word was in the beginning with God. What the Word do?
All things were made by him.
Oh, the Word is the one made all things. See, that's Jesus, brothers and sisters. Jesus made it all. The one we know is Jesus, who became a flesh and blood man. He was in the beginning with God. He made everything. Because I know that was the one we know as the Father talking to him. Mm-hmm. God said, look, let us make man in our image. Jesus turned around and boom, made man in his own image, which in turn was in their image because they won. They operate down the same page. So he said, look, verse 3, all things were made by him and what else?
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Who is that? The Word. The one that was God with God, right? In the beginning. Now skip down to verse 14, because the Word did a little, he took a low grade. The Word took a low grade. What did he do? Verse 14.
And the Word was made flesh.
Oh, later on, the Word was made flesh like us. But in the beginning, the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word created everything that was created. But then the Word was made flesh. See, this is going to tell you who the Word is now. The Word was made flesh and what?
And dwelt among us.
Uh-huh.
And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Oh, the Word became flesh and blood like us. Mm-hmm. And we dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Who is that referring to? Jesus. Jesus became a flesh and blood man. But what was he before he became a flesh and blood man? He was God. Way back in the beginning, he was God. And we're going to make sure you understand that. See, we're going to identify the two members of the Godhead. 1 Timothy 3. 1 Timothy. See, this can be kind of deep unless you really search the scriptures like Jesus told you to do. If you're trying to figure it with your natural mind, you ain't going to figure it out. But if you get it from the Bible, you got it. And you can tell anybody. You ain't got to say. See, people leave here, they ain't got to say, well, Brother Elijah say that. Like I hear people quoting their preacher like he's somebody. Your preacher going to die like anybody else. I hear them quoting their preacher. Well, you know, my pastor say so-and-so. And my pastor say so. Look, he ain't nobody. See, people leave here, they don't have to say, well, Brother Elijah said this. They can show some scripture. They can show what the Lord say. 1 Timothy 3 and 1 verse, 16. 1 verse, 1 Timothy 3, 1 verse, verse 16. Because this is not the easiest topic to grasp, but you can get it. Go ahead.
Verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness.
Mm-hmm.
God was manifested in the flesh.
Wait a minute. Without controversy, this is a great mystery. Great is the mystery of godliness. Do you really understand God? Do you really understand what Jesus was when he became a man? He was God manifested in the flesh. Mm-hmm. Didn't we just see that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God? All things were made by him, and without anything, without him was not anything made that was made. We just saw that, right? Then we saw that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, right? Mm-hmm. Well, it's the same thing. He said, God was manifest in the flesh. Now, who was manifest in the flesh? The Father has never been manifest in the flesh, has he?
No.
The Father been in heaven all along dealing with this thing. He's been a spirit being. God is a spirit. But see, Jesus gave it up. He was made flesh for our benefit, because only way he could die is to be flesh. He had to die for our sin. A spirit can't die. So he had to take a low grade and come down to our level. He took a low grade. That's a great thing for him to do. This dude was God, and he said, look, I'm going to give it up. I'm going to put on this flesh and blood to help these crazy people out. I'm going to go down there with them. So he said, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. Go ahead.
Justify in the spirit.
Yeah, because he didn't get no justice in the spirit. They killed him for nothing. But he wasn't looking for that. He looking for justice from Father, and he came back a spirit being after he raised from the dead. Justified in the spirit. What else?
Seen of angels. Preached unto the Gentiles. Believed on in the world. Received up into glory.
See, that's what Jesus did. After he did all that, he went back to heaven. And the Bible says right now, brothers and sisters, Jesus is where? Sitting at the right hand of the Father. That's where Jesus is right now. You ain't never heard of the Holy Ghost sitting on the left hand, no, have you? Uh-uh. See, if it was a Trinity, sometimes you're going to have to see all three of them repping as God. All three of them, you need to see that. You see Jesus, you see the Father sitting on the throne, Jesus on the right hand. You don't see the Holy Ghost up there sitting as God. He got a job to do, but he's not God. But now go to Philippians 2. We're gonna keep running the Godhead down. Philippians 2. See, we got to get away from all these lies that we've been fed so we could know about God the way it is. Philippians 2, and we're going to pick it up at verse 5. Philippians 2, and like I said, Jesus did a great thing. He gave up being almighty to come down and be one of us. That take a humble spirit to do that. And he telling us to have the same spirit. 2 and 5. Philippians 2 and 5. Go ahead.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus.
Let this mind. He's talking about a humble mind. And he's going to show you how humble Jesus was. What did he do to operate in humility? Go ahead.
Who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God.
Wait a minute. Who being in the form of God. Jesus was in the form of God. Didn't we read in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Right. Then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So he was God with God. He was in the form of God. Who being in the form of God, he didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God, but did what?
But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men.
See, again, Jesus didn't start with Mary. He was in the beginning with God. Then he took a low grade and became a flesh and blood man, was made in the likeness of men, was made flesh.